Good morning. How are you today? You're looking pretty good. Of course, I need glasses, but...
That's right. Hey, it is great to have you join us. If you're watching online, make sure you let us know. So it's great to have you online when you can't be in the actual service. What's happening today?
Did you want to keep that snake?
No, he killed a snake yesterday at our house.
You shouldn't say I killed it.
Oh,
I sent it to...
disposed of it.
Wherever snakes go.
But he's really violent when it comes to... I mean, I think he was scared, you know? He took that thing and...
No, you don't need to describe
it. Oh, okay. All right. You brought it up, so...
Well,
anyway.
I just thought it ought to be eliminated. How many of you think that it's okay to eliminate snakes? Okay.
It was long.
And I know there's probably some snake lovers here. You know, we were at a store the other day, and a lady had a snake... The diameter was this big, wrapped around her neck as she walked up to the counter. And I said to the person behind the counter, "Wow, that was, whoa." And she said, "Yeah, I got to pet it." And I thought, "Well, you're weird too, lady."
We definitely are not a snake handling church, but anyway, that's right.
Okay, that was pretty good.
Thanks.
Yeah.
That was not on our notes. So.
NMI Council meeting is following the AM worship.
Right. Things that are happening today, or not today, this next week. On Tuesday, there's an all-church lunch fellowship at 12:30 at the Shortstop Restaurant on Moorfield Road. And I understand they have a good pizza buffet.
They do.
So it's, Anyway, that's on Tuesday, and everyone is invited, anyone that would like to come. Then on Wednesday at 9:30 in the morning, the ladies' Bible study is meeting, and you're going to have a study first, then you're followed by lunch. And then that evening is our Hot Dog Wednesday, and that's at 6 o'clock over at the picnic shelter. Next Sunday is Sunday School promotions during this time, and so you'll get to see those kids that are being promoted to another class. Then the teens will be having a special gathering at 5 o'clock next Sunday evening at Pastor Jeff and Carol's home. I'm sure you'll get information about that. The outreach, tell us about the outreach.
Yeah, school supplies. If you noticed in the foyer, there's some nice baskets there filled with nice new packages. I told the ladies I loved new packages of crayons. I never liked it when the teacher would hand you these little broken pieces with the rounded off. So anyway, school supplies in those baskets, and we need to bring those in for Kenton Elementary, and that's part of our ministry to that school.
Right. Coming up the last Sunday, I believe in August, is called Summer Highlights Sunday, and we're going to be showing you pictures of our children and teens and special activities that they've, like their favorite activity that they've done for the summer. So if you have a picture, if you are a parent of a child or teens, make sure you send in a picture to the church email, and we will get that PowerPoint ready. Pastor Missy will actually get that ready. So
you should have taken a picture of me doing some snake killing yesterday.
Yeah, I should have. We could probably find that snake and wrap it around your neck.
No, let's not do that.
There we go.
Anyway,
right,
moving on.
Anyway, hey, a couple congratulations. Joe Rivers, he's going to be doing our special music this morning. But anyway, he just recently retired from Wright Pat. So
all
congratulations.
All right, Joe, you go, buddy.
So pray for Sheila, not really. And a special couple we want to introduce you to,
yes.
Robin, Stan, and Jonathan. This is Robin.
Guess what? Little Robin.
She has a ring on her finger.
Little Robin has a ring on her finger.
Yeah. So there.
And I've already begun the interrogation, and
that's
he's
right.
Passing so far.
Yeah. I haven't started my interview process with him, though.
I've got a
few questions. But anyway, they are planning a spring wedding, so congratulations to both of you. So it's great to have you in church today.
Well, good morning again, everyone. Glad to be with you here today to lead in worship. And I want us to just, as we enter into this next song this morning, in a moment I'm going to ask you to stand as we worship together, because this is one that is difficult if you're not playing a piano to stay seated for, I think. Because we have this beautiful image that comes out in this song. It's really from the last book of the New Testament, John's revelation of Jesus Christ that we have. When all of the living creatures, when all of creation is coming together around the throne of God. And there's so many different songs and hymns that come from the book of Revelation. And one of the most striking parts is when all of the creatures are together and they are crying out, singing to the Lord, casting down their golden crowns around the glassy sea. And they are saying to one another three words. What are they? Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts, the Lord God Almighty, the one who is worthy. So this morning, we are joining our voices together with those who have gone before us, those who are here right now, and we are in the presence of the same God on both sides of eternity today, aren't we, this morning? We get to worship on this side with those who are also on the other side. So we rejoice together that there is this God who we are told nothing can separate us from. Not life, not death, nothing in all creation. Our Lord is here to unite us this morning. Will you stand with us as we sing of this incredible God, holy, 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 as we are here on holy ground this morning. Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty, As we go into our prayer time this morning, with just our voices, maybe sing that last verse again. It just says, holy, holy, holy Lord God Almighty, all thy works shall praise thy name in sky and sea. Holy, 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 merciful and mighty, God in three persons, blessed Trinity.
We serve and worship a mighty God. As we go to prayer today, I just want to remind you that He still answers prayer. My wife and I had an extended time of prayer the other night, and the next morning, she wrote in her journal about the prayer request, and at that very moment, a phone call came as an answer to that prayer request. Don't tell me that that's a coincidence. And if it is, then God majors in divine coincidences. I just thought maybe somebody needed to hear that today. Sometimes we need a boost in our faith. As we pray today, we want to remember Beth Kramer, Linda Lockwood's daughter. We want to remember those in our church family who've dealt with COVID, dealing with COVID, may deal with COVID. COVID, COVID, COVID. But we're not going to back down. We'll deal with it and move on, won't we? Dorothy is Janine's mother. Jack is Marcia Hiles' great-nephew. Of course, we need to continue to remember Jeff and Vicki Berg, Joyce Bryant, friend of the Richies, Mary Beth, aunt of Ashton Womex, Megan, neighbor of Sharma. Let's continue to remember the Weaver family and others who have dealt with that terrible tragedy a couple weeks ago. Stephanie is Pat Fry's friend, and then Mrs. Corwin D. Hale's mother. Would you mind
if you and your family came forward, would that be okay? Would you bring her with you, your mom? I'm going to invite the Womack family to come forward if they would. This is not an easy time, as you know. Scott, Greg's brother, Nancy's younger son, passed away in the Philippines yesterday. And I know we've had other losses in our family, in our church family. I don't want to, you know, play favorites by any means, but this is a very unique situation, as you might guess. And anytime a parent has to attend the funeral of a child, no matter how old that child is, it's very difficult. Thank you. Let's begin our prayer with the prayer Jesus taught his disciples, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. In the face of tragedy, in the face of temptation, in the face of death, we still proclaim the power, the presence, the authority, the sovereignty of God. You have not left the scene, and we're very thankful for that. Today we talk about faith. We struggle in our faith. Sometimes we shine in our faith. Lord, you know all about it, and you're with us in every situation, in every stage of life. When we think of this long list of prayer requests, and you know about every one of them, we lay them at your feet. You know those who would like to see themselves healed physically, restored to health in this life. You know those who really would like some direction in their lives. You know those who are hurting emotionally and just really could use some peace and some relief and some rest. Lord, you know about all of those needs. As we name those names and those situations, we brought them to you today. Lord, we want to focus especially on the Womack family. Once again, our church family has experienced great loss, but particularly very unique loss in this case because so many miles away, a young son. We pray for this dear lady that your blessing would be upon her, that she would sense the peace of Jesus, the comfort of Jesus, even as you promised in your word. She's served you all these years. She's confident that her son is with you, and for that we are very grateful, Jesus. We're just in the midst and in the face of this. Let's just say thank you, Jesus, that Scott is with you. Let's do that together. Thank you, Jesus, that Scott is with you. And for this brother and for sister-in-law and aunts and uncles and this family, we pray, Lord God, that you would bring the peace and the comfort that you promise in your word. We don't pretend to think that this prayer time is going to take care of everything. There's going to be days of tears and pain and sorrow. But Lord, we are proclaiming today together that you are still on the throne. You're still God. Jesus, you're still the great Son of God who intercedes for us. And we ask that you would do that even now for this family. We thank you for their lives, for their friendship. And we just pray, Lord, that you would bring comfort around them, that you would wrap your loving arms around them. Thank you for this church family. who gathers together when loss happens and rejoices when things are worth rejoicing. We give you praise today, Jesus. It's in the strong name of Jesus that we're praying these prayers. King of kings and Lord of lords, coming again someday. And it's in his name we pray, and all God's people said, amen, amen. Thank you. You may be seated. Our ushers are prepared to come, and we're going to receive our morning offering, and let's continue to praise the Lord for the privilege of giving. The kingdom is yours. We ask that you would build it by these gifts. We give you praise in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good morning. Before all the kids come, if you kids went to camp with me this week, can you come on up here? And Jill, I'll have Jill come too. Yeah, go ahead. Yeah, the older ones that came with me this week. We survived. We made it. So if you want to tell us, you don't have to, but if you want to tell us your favorite thing or something that you enjoyed this week, you can. Do you want to tell us something? Yes. Okay, I'm ready.
Is it purple? Yes. Okay. We did slip and slide kickball, but it hurts.
That's true, yeah. But you got a bath because it was soapy. So that was a plus. Okay, scooch over for me, would you? Okay. All right, Garrett.
Getting counselors out in like every game.
Your goal was to get them out in the games? Okay, all right, that's all right. Hi. What did you enjoy about camp this week?
Probably swimming.
Swimming.
Yeah, very good. All right. Okay, Clay, I'm ready for you.
What did you enjoy?
Hanging out with mom.
Hanging out with your mom. Aw, God bless you. Okay. Oh, and also, he very bravely came to this camp because he had fair the previous week. So he was actually younger than a lot of the kids that were there. And he still, we had like a Bible section rotation every day. And he got second place out of all those boys because he was answering all these questions. So we're really proud of you. Did you know that you were going to get second place, or was that a surprise?
No, I just jumped up at every question.
You just kept jumping, right? All right, well, apparently it paid off. So if you want to see him after church, I'm sure he'll show you his medal. So we're really proud of him.
Basketball or slip and slide, kickball.
Okay, all right. And Jill, thank you so much for coming. I really appreciate it. If you want to, whatever you want to say is fine.
Well, the first night they do counselor hide and seek, and I thought I'd be terrible, but De'Asia gave me a great hiding place, and I was one of the last counselors to be found. I was very proud of that.
Yeah, you were gone so long that Clay's like, I don't know if my mom knows where she is. I said, oh, I think your mom knows where she is. So, but we had a great time. It was a good time. I'm glad you guys all got to come with me, and thanks for coming with me. I appreciate it. So, all right, we'll let you guys stay here, and all the other kids that are here, if you guys want to come up for prayer, we'll pray together, and you guys can pick your spot. Be praying for those who are on vacation. We've got lots of families gone
getting in those last-minute vacations before school starts. I know I'm not allowed to really say that word, but it's coming slowly but surely, right? Let's pray together. Jesus, thank you for this day. Thank you for another week that you have brought us through. And thank you for these children and for what they mean to us. I pray for those who are on vacation. We know that several families are away today, that you would just be with them and help them, keep them safe. And for those of us who are here, I just pray that you would be with us, that we would hear from you today so that we can further your kingdom. We ask all this in your name. Amen.
Wonderful children right here. Well, our newest retiree is going to have our special music this morning. Let's welcome him.
Somebody asked me, why does a Christian sing the blues? You should never be sad, but always spread the good news. You can't judge a man until you walked in his shoes. And doesn't he know that even Jesus had the blues? When the children of Israel didn't like the promised land, hit the rock, God wouldn't let him in. Everybody gets the blues now and then. Now the only way to make those blues go away is to let the blood of Jesus make you clean today. He'll take the crimson stain and make it white as snow, so you can go to heaven, not to hell below. Was the first bluesman around. He played the blues harp back when Saul wore the crown. You can read about his troubles, sorrow and strife that started when he took Bathsheba for a wife. Now the only way to make those blues go away is to let the blood of Jesus make you clean today. He'll take the crimson stain and make it white as snow, so you can go to heaven, not to hell below. When Adam bit the apple and started to chew, and Noah was in the ark, man, what a zoo. When John the Baptist was in prison, well, he had him too. But if you walk in the light, he'll help you see it through. Now the only way to make those blues go away is to let the blood of Jesus make you clean today. And take the crimson stain and make it white as snow, so you can go to heaven, not to hell below.
Joe. He's always got some very creative music for us. Thank you. Thank you. Guitar was blue too. I like that. I like that. Well, today's all about faith. We have a video, I think. Do we have a video player back there? Let's hit it.
Okay, guys, what is faith?
Faith is... It's kind of like a... could you hold the camera? I just need to think. Faith. God?
Faith is not far. Faith is when you have courage to do something and you do it and you believe you can do it.
If you like think that you can't do something, but then you believe that you can do it.
It's when you believe something before you see it.
And you're obeying God? Is that right? Or is that the wrong answer?
Faith is believing without seeing.
You can feel it and you can see it in your head before you see it.
Believing that something's gonna happen and trusting God.
Faith is believing in something that you cannot see, feel, or have any way of seeing it. Well, you can actually see it, but I mean, like, you can see it. Having faith is like seeing it in the future.
Still one of my favorites is the kid that said, faith is what you know ain't so. Mark 9 begins with Jesus and three of his closest disciples. They climb a mountain. We call it the Mount of Transfiguration. It's an experience that they would never forget. Jesus' clothes turn dazzling white. They are visited by two famous dead guys, Moses and Elijah. Simon Peter, of course, never at a loss for words, suggests that they should build three tabernacles or three shelters, three tents for each of those famous guys. They hear a voice from the Heavenly Father, "This is my beloved Son, listen to him." Then it quickly ends like that, and they're left alone with Jesus. They begin to descend the mountain with the rest of the disciples who are at the base of the mountain, and they encounter a situation that's going on that will require an understanding of different stages of faith. Let's read about it in Mark chapter 9, beginning at verse 14. When they came to the other disciples, they saw a large crowd around them and the teachers of the law arguing with them. As soon as all the people saw Jesus, they were overwhelmed with wonder and ran to greet him. "What are you arguing with them about?" he asked. A man in the crowd answered, "Teacher, I brought you my son who is possessed by a spirit that has robbed him of speech. Whenever it seizes him, it throws him to the ground. He foams at the mouth, he gnashes his teeth and becomes rigid. I asked your disciples to drive out the spirit, but they could not." "You unbelieving generation," Jesus replied, "how long shall I stay with you? How long shall I put up with you? Bring the boy to me." So they brought him. When it saw Jesus, it immediately threw the boy into a convulsion. He fell to the ground and rolled around, foaming at the mouth. Jesus asked the boy's father, "How long has he been like this?" "From childhood," he answered. "It has often thrown him into the fire or water to kill him. But if you can do anything, take pity on us and help us." "If you can," said Jesus, and if you have a red letter edition, it says, "Everything is possible for the one who believes." Immediately the boy's father exclaimed, "I do believe. Help me overcome my unbelief." When Jesus saw that a crowd was running to the scene, he rebuked the impure spirit. "You deaf and mute spirit," he said, "I command you, come out of him and never enter him again." The spirit shrieked, convulsed him violently, and came out. The boy looked so much like a corpse that many said he's dead. But Jesus took him by the hand and lifted him to his feet, and he stood up. After Jesus had gone indoors, his disciples asked him privately, "Why couldn't we drive it out?" Jesus replied, "This kind can come out only by prayer." So where is your faith journey today?
There are three levels at least of faith that we see in this story. First of all, we see those that are without faith, or at least they're not applying their faith to Jesus. They're the teachers of the law of all people. They were the religious ones. Did you know that you can be religious and not have a relationship with God? Did you know that you can come to church every week, sing the songs, look like you're praying, maybe you are praying, maybe even put a little money into the offering plate? You can look religious and yet not have a relationship with God. Did you know that? It's true. And unfortunately, these religious leaders, many of them did not have a relationship with God. They got all the requirements down. They knew exactly what needed to be done as far as the law. They had even been among those who had watched Jesus perform some miracles, including raising Lazarus from the dead. You might think after witnessing what Jesus could do that they would have placed their faith in Jesus, but no, you know what they were doing? They were arguing with the disciples. In fact, they might have even been taunting the disciples because they were having trouble in their faith as well. We'll talk about them in a moment. You see, these guys were used to being in charge and used to being in charge of other people's lives. And they weren't about to give up their trust and being in charge and their control to Jesus. He might rearrange some things. He might even change their way of thinking. He might even require behavior changes. Which brings us to the second group of people, those of wavering faith. Now, the first ones were without faith because they didn't apply their faith to Jesus at all. Well, this group is a wavering faith. These are the disciples that were at the bottom of the mountain. They weren't on the mountain with Jesus. They were at the bottom of the mountain dealing with this situation. Let's go back to verses 18 and 19 of Mark 9. I asked your disciples to drive out the spirit, but they could not. Jesus replies, you unbelieving generation, how long shall I stay with you? How long shall I put up with you? Bring the boy to me. These disciples were not with Jesus on the mountain, like I said. So maybe we ought to cut them some slack. But the truth is, these disciple guys had also witnessed Jesus and his ability to perform miracles. They had seen him cast out demons with their own eyes. Yet it came time for them to take care of the need. They wavered in their faith. It's a serious indictment that comes from the father of this boy, isn't it? When he says, I asked your disciples to drive out the demon and they could not. Christ followers need to be careful of the way they are perceived in public, especially when people are asking them. By the way, I just got to stop right here. I had one of our people that are here today come to me and say, you know, I decided to try it. It said, I had a person that called me and they were obviously in distress and I saw them and I talked to them and I actually prayed with them. I didn't, you know, I was uncomfortable with it and so forth. And now they're calling me again. he said, now I feel like I'm being stalked. But anyway, I said, no, God is using you. God is using you. But in this case, the Father came to the disciples and they could not. Kind of reminds me of the pilot who was having a little trouble with his airplane. Plane was full of passengers. He comes on the loudspeaker. I'm sorry, engine one has gone out, but don't worry, we've got three engines left. You know how this goes. You've heard these things before. Comes back on the loudspeaker a little later and he said, I'm sorry, engine two has gone out. And then wouldn't you know it, a little later, I'm sorry, engines three and four have gone out. Well, that's it. Next thing you know, they look down the corridor, and there's the pilot standing there with a parachute on his back. And he said, don't worry, folks, I'm going out for help. That's kind of the way these disciples were that day. These disciples, at least, needed to ask some wisdom from God to perform what was being needed. You know, James chapter 1 says this, verse 6. But when you ask, you must believe and not doubt, because the one who doubts is like a wave of the sea blown and tossed by the wind. That person should not expect to receive anything from the Lord. Such a person is double-minded and unstable in all they do. And the disciples that were at the base of the mountain dealing with this father and his son were wavering in their faith. chapter 9, verse 28 and 29, they come to Jesus, these disciples do, and they ask him privately, why couldn't we drive it out? And Jesus says, this kind can only come out by prayer. And I know that there's some of you who have translations that their word fasting is added to the end of that verse. But the bottom line is this. It's not that they needed to pray extra right then at that moment to get rid of this demon. It wasn't that all of a sudden they had to give up their lunch, that noon meal, for fasting at that moment. No, the whole point of that is that it's not so much about prayer and fasting as it is that there needs to be a constant connection with God that makes us ready when the time comes for our faith to be exercised. And if it takes prayer and fasting to do it, then do it. But be ready when the time comes. And the only way you can be ready is to be connected with God constantly through prayer, Bible study, and interacting with God's people. Maybe you're like these disciples. You've witnessed the work of God. Maybe it was last week. Maybe it was last year. Maybe it was yesterday. Do you remember that time when that person you knew was healed? Maybe it was you. But since then, it's kind of, you know, fogged over. And will you trust him this time? To direct your life, to forgive your sin, to heal you, to cleanse you, to help you? He's helped you in the past. Won't he help you now? That's why I told you at the beginning of this story, at the beginning of this day, at the beginning of this time together, that we had prayer the other day, and the next morning, right when she wrote it down in her journal, boom, a phone call came that was a direct answer to that prayer. Don't tell me that's a coincidence. Wavering faith. Well, that brings us to the final one. Weak faith. The father of this son cried, I believe. You want to say it with me? Help my unbelief. This man's son, by the way, was possessed by an evil spirit. Now, of course, in our sophisticated culture, you might dismiss it as only epilepsy because it had some of those symptoms. But the scripture makes it clear that in this case, behind those symptoms that look like epilepsy was an evil spirit. Or else it wouldn't have responded to the presence of Jesus the way it did, right? We don't need to fear a demon behind every rock and tree, don't get me wrong. But we do need to be wise. He isn't going to come out to you in a red suit and horns and a pitchfork and say, here I am, boo. It doesn't work that way. We need to heed what the scripture says about our real enemy. 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 8 says, be alert and of sober mind. Your enemy, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion looking for someone to devour. In John 10:10, Jesus said, the thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy, and I have come that they may have life and have it to the full. In John 8, verse 44, Jesus is talking to his detractors, those who are against him, and he says, you belong to your father, the devil, and you want to carry out your father's desires. He was a murderer from the beginning. This is Jesus talking, not holding to the truth, for there is no truth in him. When he lies, he speaks his native language, for he is a liar and the father of lies. Hello? The devil is a liar. There is a devil. You can call it the evil realm. You can call it whatever you want, but it's there. Have you ever noticed? So a word to the wise. The devil is out to eat your lunch. I think about this story and I wonder, obviously the boy is going through misery. But what's his father dealing with? I wonder what this father's been dealing with all these years, with a son dealing with these physical manifestations as well as obviously a demon. With a son in this miserable condition, were things going through his mind like, what voices were in his head saying, did I cause this issue for my son? Is this my fault? Parents, grandparents, aunts, uncles, have you ever wondered if maybe you were the influence as to why this situation isn't so great? What are the voices that go through our minds? I must be a terrible parent. Wonder what people think of me having a son that acts out like this. You know those mind battles, don't you? Am I the only one here that ever has mind battles? You know what I'm talking about? So often there are suggestions from the evil one to keep us down. He introduces thoughts, and you begin to think they're your own. He will attack what's most important to you, where it will hurt the most. Paul says it this way in Ephesians chapter 6, verse 10. Finally, be strong in the Lord and his mighty power. Put on the full armor of God so that you can take your stand against the devil's schemes. For our struggle is not against flesh and blood. So you thought it was the spouse. You thought it was the boss. You thought it was the jerk that pulled out in front of you. No, it's not. Our struggle is not against flesh and blood, believe it or not. He goes on and he says, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the powers of this dark world, and against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms. Listen, you can't win an argument with the devil. He will try to get you to question the integrity of God. He did with Eve, didn't he? Did God really say? He even did with Jesus, didn't he? If you are the Son of God. That's what he does. That's his job. If I gave him a compliment, I would say he does that very well. He's a liar. But you can win by putting the whole armor of God on and familiarizing yourself with the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. It is a spiritual battle, and it starts in the mind. I wonder what was going through this father's mind. Had he been talked into believing that he needed to give up on God? Then he heard some rumors about a man named Jesus. Have you ever heard any rumors about a man named Jesus? Who was performing some amazing things. So when Jesus came on the scene, down from that mountain, of course Jesus' reputation's already damaged because his disciples are failing at the job. So the Father says, if you can do anything, because obviously these guys can't pull it off, and Jesus declares, everything is possible for the one who believes. Everything is possible for the one who believes. You mean it's possible that my marriage can be put back together? Oh, yes. You mean that it is possible that there is hope for my wayward child? Oh, yeah. You mean that my job might actually improve? Certainly. You mean my son, in this case, might get better? Yeah. The father cries, I believe. Help my unbelief. You ever been there? I believe. Help my unbelief. Maybe that's the spot you're sitting on today. You feel God has let you down before, and you want to believe, but it's kind of scary. This father was out of ideas, he was out of solutions, and he was desperate. And sometimes that's exactly where God needs us to be so he can begin to work. So the father was willing to let Jesus do whatever Jesus could do. His faith was weak, but he trusted Jesus anyway. Some of you truly believe, you know in your mind technically that he can fix whatever it is. However, you are anxious about it and you are afraid of how it's going to turn out. But that's okay as long as you give him a chance. Give him half a chance. Let me ask you this morning, give Jesus half a chance and it will be worth it. Hebrews 12:2, fixing our eyes on Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of our faith. Help my unbelief. You know what amazes me about this event? Every time I read it, every time I preach on it, I'm just always amazed by this. The miracle didn't happen in response to those without faith. The miracle didn't happen for those with wavering faith. He basically had to brush those disciples aside and say, bring the boy to me. No, the miracle happened when a man in his honesty said, I believe, help my unbelief. Jesus went ahead and healed anyway. Can you imagine? Can you imagine the exuberant joy this man must have experienced? Oh, wow. I guess you could say this father gave Jesus half a chance and it was worth it. I got to thinking, who else gave God half a chance? Well, there was Noah. Now, I'm just reading between some lines here. I didn't read this in the scripture, but you got to know that Noah had some neighbors that thought he was absolutely out of his mind, right? But he gave God at least half a chance, and it was worth it. I think about Abraham. Boy, that poor man, talk about wavering in his faith and weak in his faith, but when the time came, he gave God a chance, and it was worth it. I think about Moses. God calls Moses to go to Pharaoh and tell my people, let my people go. And Moses says, I can't talk. And God says, all right, then let your brother Aaron do the talking. He gave God half a chance, though, and it was worth it. I think about David, little shepherd boy David. You know, here's a shepherd boy out there minding his own business, tending his sheep, and next thing he knows, he's being called to be the king of Israel. Well, there's a little problem. There's another king that isn't quite ready for that to happen. So he's running half of his life from people who are trying to kill him when he's the rightful king, and yet he gave God half a chance. One of my favorite stories, of course, is when he faced that guy by the name of Goliath. Remember that? Do you remember that story? You remember the rest of all of Israel looked at that big giant and said, he's too big, we can't fight him. Do you know what David said? He said, he's so big, I can't miss him. Gave God at least half a chance, didn't he? And then there were 12 disciples. Yeah, they wavered in their faith. There were times they were weak in their faith. But on the day of Pentecost, when they were filled with the Spirit, they changed the world for life. And you and I wouldn't be sitting here and standing here today if it hadn't been for them. Giving God at least half a chance. And there is you and there is me. Are you saying, I believe, but help my unbelief today? I beg you. I am begging you. Give God half a chance. It's going to be worth it. Stand with me. As we do this closing song this morning, the words some of you will recognize, just as I am, just come as you are. If you need to pray this morning, you say, I was at the altar last week. Good. Come again. How many times have I said, if you have to ride this thing to heaven, then do it. I believe. I've been there. You think preachers have some special dispensation that they don't deal with weak faith and wavering faith? You don't think there are times when we just say, God, I don't know where you are. I'm about to give up. But I'm asking you this morning, give him half a chance. And I'm guaranteeing to you, it will be worth it. I have a closing prayer in a moment, but I just want to let the Holy Spirit work. Let him do his work. He's the one anyway, as we sing. Well, if you're new to us today, just to let you know, this is a place where we receive help. It's not the only place, of course, but it's a special place set aside in the church. We've all been here. There's some of you that probably still need to think about it. That's another story. But we have all received help, and it's a good place for it, and we always leave on a victorious note. We thank the Lord. Thank you for being here today. You know, Joe's song was right. Sometimes we have the blues. But that's not the final word, and it doesn't need to be the final word. God bless you and make His face shine upon you and give you peace and joy anyway. God bless you. You're dismissed.